Hello, everybody. Good morning.
We are very happy with your lecture from last time, and I'm sure today will be same interesting and useful for our coaches. So don't waste the time. The time is short for our lecture, and let's begin. So, Tribune for you, Nenad.
Thank you very much.
That's short, good formalities before we just actually begin. Just I want to inform everybody that this lecture and this seminar will be recorded, audio and video recorded, and it will be published on FIBA and Lithuanian Basketball Federation websites. And we are kindly asking all the participants to mute their microphones during the clinic. And Nenad, please go on.
Thank you very much. So good morning or good afternoon, whatever, for all of you coaches. I hope all of you are healthy and ready to get some information from my side. So as we said last week, this clinic is practically made by two clinics, and the second one is a continuation of the first one. So in the first session, if you remember, we discussed about talent identification and selection of the players. And today we will cover so different topic, keeping the same way. So practically today, I will try to cover topics visible on this slide. So practically what we need to do in order to develop in the right way selected players, how to implement practice plan and practice program from under 8 to under 14 mostly. We discussed that it's not necessary to explain everything for all the age group because it's take time, it's long road. After that, I will share with you some systems, if there is a system in Serbian Basketball Federation, about the competition system, about the rules, my personal experience too, about working with kids, because twice I was coordinator of youth program in Serbian Basketball Federation, and of course some thoughts or some personal advices for the coaches, just to enrich your experience in this field. So let's start with technical stuff. So first of all, this question, can we play in a basketball career or not? I think yes, because as I said last time, and I think that we finish with this slide, not with this, but with same sentence, that we're supposed to have knowledge in order to reduce probability to make mistakes. But of course, all of us are going to make mistakes. Definitely, we want to eliminate X factor, but we can play in basketball career because we are earning money doing that stuff, all of us. So we have different aspects of preparation from psychological point of view. We need some specific equipment, of course, for development of our players, biomechanical analysis, physiological stuff like training, nutrition, health, injury, all those stuff. So it's clear that if we are investing our time and if we are doing the stuff, we can create winners. Of course, as we discussed in the last session, in first session, so there are some genetically given abilities, skills, but of course, winners are made, definitely not born, because especially in today's world, it's not so easy to get top players. Hypothetically, what we must have, what's supposed to be profile of top basketball player. So starting from the foundation, from basic anthropological characteristics, of course, they're supposed to be healthy, so health, morphological aspects of preparation, so body size and constitution. After that, conditioning or motor and functional abilities or capabilities of the player. Cognitive abilities, so they're supposed to have some specific psychological profile, and cognitive abilities that they must have motivation to practice it and to play basketball. After, on the next level, on the next floor, we have specific conditioning for basketball. We have technical and tactical preparation of level, different levels of technical and tactical skills. Of course, also, as we discussed, for different positions on the court, from 1 to 5 and different age group. Then we have competitive preparation, first of all, for clubs. Clubs preparation for local, national, and then for international level. Of course, during all the time, from the very first practice until the end of career, there is a big a very important part of theoretical preparation, especially today basketball and today world, with a lot of video analysis, with a lot of technical stuff we can show to them, because as we are saying in Serbia, mostly basketball players and generally athletes, they are most visual types, so they like to see the stuff. We are saying here in Serbia, one picture means more than 1,000 words, and I think this is the worldwide. So then in the end of the story, of course, we have psychosocial preparation, because basketball is team sport, and we should also consider those stuff, how they will react and how they will react in the team. As we said before, so we have different process, different steps. First of all, talent identification and selection, then training programs and monitoring practices. All those stuff must be specific, must be creative, because we have not received to make top basketball players. There is not, it's not so easy. So if there is a receipt, all of us are going to make Coca-Cola or Burger King or top players. And in the end of the story, synthesis skills of the players and the synthesis skills of the coaches and also managers, people who are leading federations, who are leading clubs. It's live things, so we cannot find one solution. It's not, everything is not measurable in basketball. Some questions for career planning for all of us, of development of the players. First of all, can we play in a basketball career? I think yes. Important steps to become a basketball professional, professional basketball player. There is a summer, there are the, some key points or some key ingredients in certain time, at a certain time and a certain age of the players, and which kind of skills we can develop in some specific part of childhood. We will talk about that, about sensitive zones or training windows of trainability. To pay attention to, so school, family, social environment, girls, boyfriends, and of course, how we can prevent our players from dropping out of the basketball. This is very interesting, and I don't think that we can find the, you know, easy answer, because today basketball kids start, the kids are starting playing basketball in very early, early age, 6, 7. So think about some kids in under 16 who are already 8 or 10 years in basketball. How to keep them in, how to avoid and prevent them dropping out from basketball. So it's a complex question. Of course, we should do our job in the right way, and all the knowledge we should use to keep them in, especially if we are discussing about top prospect players, because as you know, mostly kids who are starting to play basketball or other sport, probably just couple of 2-3% of them are going to achieve top level. So, but it's important to keep them in, because probably some of them are going to be coaches, referees, sport directors, you know, team management, they will feel the team management stuff, who knows. After that, when they should start to play on the senior level, in the end of the session, I will spend a couple of minutes also talking about it. And of course, how to include national team in that development, how to make this collaboration between clubs, and national teams, or clubs, coaches, clubs, and national team coaches. So, which is not so easy to combine all those stuff, because probably national team coaches, they have different criteria, they have different things to work with players. So, a lot of questions, and of course, all of us are trying to do our best in order to provide conditions for talented kids to become top basketball player, or how to develop them. Of course, inside we have also injury prevention, nutrition, healthy lifestyle, and all other stuff which are not related directly to the basketball, but they are influencing a lot on basketball, especially with 2 kids. As I said before, it's too easy to say than to do, but let's start to find some answers. So first of all, children are not little adults. So we cannot use training technology from senior teams with them, because they are not senior, physically, technically, tactically, mentally, whatever, socially. So first of all, this is the big difference, because some young coaches are thinking that it's enough just to copy practices from top teams and using with kids. And of course, this is not good. First of all, because they are not ready for that kind of practice. And secondly, psychologically, if they are not ready, they are not going to do well all the drills, all the skills, so then they will lose interest to play basketball. So, and there are a lot of different stuff before to to jump in the senior in senior shoes. So how to train kids? Of course, kill the players on the court. Probably in your country, in Serbia, a lot of coaches made that stuff and still they are doing that stuff. Of course, it's not right, right way and right approach. We should work hard, but we should work smart. So as I said before, target, laser targeting. So we should understand what we should do in a specific age and how to do with specific kids. Generally, and of course, in the end, also make some individual programs for specific needs of special talented players. Of course, don't kill the kids. Before to start, we should understand some basic stuff from theory of sports training, so meaning of chronological age, developmental age, and critical period of development. So chronological age refers to the number of years and days elapsed since birth. So kids can be 14 years and 2 months old. This is clear. Developmental age or biological age refers to the degree of physical, mental, cognitive, and emotional maturity of the kids. So not all the kids born in the same age, in the same year, in the same month are the same, you know, all of you. So we have so many different bodies, different heads, different coordination level of the kids, especially because in basketball is not individual sport. In basketball, we have groups pairing 2 years, so under 12, under 14, under 16. So you can have in under 14 kids who are 12 chronologically and kids who are 14 chronologically. But biologically, like developmental age, kids from 12 can be 10 and kids from 16 can be, kids from 14 can be 16 years old. So this is the big difference between their bodies, between their psychological characteristics. So definitely we should consider those stuff because mostly top players are coming, are growing up late. So we should consider those stuff because sometimes we are looking just for that day, for that month, for that year, but this is not enough. We should consider also developmental age of the kids because probably some of them are going to mature later and they will become top players. If you are going to cut them without considering difference between developmental age and chronological age, this is one of the biggest mistakes in youth. Then we have next step, how to develop those kids. So windows of trainability or sensitive zones or critical periods for development or of developments refers to the point of development when with proper practice, we can have maximal answer of kids. So this is the period in development of kids when with proper practice, I should underline, we can develop much more some abilities. If you are going to miss that window of trainability or that sensitive zone, practically is impossible to make it in the later part of career. So this is very important to understand at the beginning. So practically, as I said before, sensitive periods are critical development phase in which we have achieved maximal training effects, of course, with proper training and with proper approach to the kids. This is very important to prevent early specialization because, as you know, there are many examples worldwide, in Serbia and Lithuania and other countries, that we had some players being dominate players in under 14, under 16, and then disappear for the senior level. Definitely, we should understand as the coaches, and as a federation, and as a club, as I said last in the first session, that we can divide basketball in two basketballs, let's say like this. So youth program basketball and senior basketball. Youth program basketball has one main goal, to develop players and to improve them enough to be ready to be competitive on the senior level. So this is main goal. Main goal for senior competition is to win at any cost. Doesn't matter if you are discussing about a fourth Lithuanian or Serbian league or we are talking about NBA. Senior basketball, meaning of senior basketball is competition and winning. Of course, not all the team can win the title, but for some team, winning means remain in the first division. For some team, winning means to also develop some kids or some players who can be sold after that. So this is another stuff, but definitely we should understand that in youth program, which is our topic, we should prevent early specialization, teaching them exactly what we need to teach them in some specific age. So I prepared here a couple of tables related to windows of trainability or sensitive zone. So as you can see, coordination, sensitive zone for coordination is from 6 to 10. Same with girls. Girls are always going two years earlier than boys because physiologically they are going to mature before the boys. So coordination, what is the meaning of coordination? Without thinking just about coordination like physical ability, technical skills. So from age of 6 to age of 10, it's window of trainability for coordination. So if we are starting to teach kids basketball skills, technical skills, passing, shooting, dribbling, in that age, we have big chance to teach them well. Of course, if you are good coaches, if you are choosing right things, but definitely they can learn. They are willing, they are eager to learn new skills, and physiologically, technically, they are ready to learn. So this is very important. Acceleration, later on, from 12 to 14 with boys, 10 to 12 with girls, agility, other stuff are coming later. But it's important to understand that, so first, practically, first things to teach kids, or when they are starting with mini basket programs, are free basic skills, especially basic abilities, not skills. Coordination, speed, and aerobic endurance. Of course, some of you can say, okay, coach, professor, how you can say coordination and okay, speed, how we can teach them speed? This is one exception. So we can teach from the beginning, from very first day of the mini basket practices, them speed. We can work on speed. We cannot teach them speed, but we can work on speed, but with one exception. So we should expect and we should pretend from kids to do skills with maximal speed only if they are doing technically correct. If they are doing wrongly technically, don't pretend from them, don't push them in competitive drills. Because first thing, as I said before, is correct technique, then repetition, then intensity. If you are doing opposite, if they are running against each other, if they are doing any kind of competition, they are not thinking about technique. So being in competitive mood, they will forget everything about technique, and they will come out of the practice with bad habits. So one of the biggest mistakes in youth program, especially in the initial part of basketball or in mini basketball, is to pretend from kids to do the stuff with high speed, with maximum speed. So there is a sensitive zone, as you can see here on this diagram. So here you can see that it's sensitive zone for a speed development also from 6 to 11. Yes, but only well executed skills. This is very, very important because without considering that stuff, we can make big mistake, practically impossible to correct in the later part of their career. As you can see here, so practically from 6 to 10 or 11, we can do everything. Of course, we cannot develop strain, or you can see as we can develop in this part. And of course that kids, probably it's strange to see that speed reaction, or generally speed is, it can be also in the lower level in the later part, as you can see speed reaction here from 10 to 16, 17, it's not so good. Of course, they're going to be faster, boys and girls. Boys and girls from 15, 16 are going to be faster to running or to do something from point A to point B than kids from 10. But we should consider that that kind of speed is based most on the difference in strain than in the speed. Speed reaction and speed can be developed very well from age to 6 to age to 11. So practically when they start growing up very fast, girls 10, 9, some of them, boys 11, 12, this is the critical part, critical moment for speed and coordination development. But before that, we can develop very, very well speed. We can develop very, very well coordination. So we can teach them basketball skills, dribbling, passing, shooting, all the stuff. And we can work on aerobic endurance. Of course, we don't need to put them on, we don't need to push them to run 45 minutes on the athletic track and field piste. But we can do a lot of stuff with ball on the normal regular practices. So, but don't forget that aerobic endurance, speed, and coordination are most important part, most important abilities to develop for the kids. Going back here, I find out some interesting table about explosive power of lower limbs or lower extremities, explosive power of legs. But definitely, explosive power of legs is most important characteristic of top basketball players. So, but you can see here in which age can be developed. So if you are watching girls, which is very, very interesting, so practically they are going to develop 90% of their potential in explosive power before 16. So that's mean that if you're going to miss that part in developing explosive power of legs, nothing to do for girls. Not nothing to do, but they will develop with less quality and with bad rhythm. Not so important. For boys who are going to mature a little bit late, it's a little bit better, but you can see also in under 16 already, we are exploring almost 70% of their potential in explosive power. So this is very important to understand because of practice plan. If you are not considering those factors, if you are not implementing those that kind of knowledge in our practice plan, in development programs, we are bad coaches and we cannot develop top players. So, of course, not all the players can be Ferraris, but we should work, we should touch, as I said before, sensitive zones in order to use their body and their mind and their abilities on the maximal level. So to explore all their potential. This is our goal as a coaches. Not all of them can be Kobe Bryant and Michael Jordan, Sabonis, Marchionis, but our job as a coaches is to explore all possible, let's say, resources from them. So our job, as I said before, if you remember last session, talent identification and selection, we have five fields. Morphological area, area of motor abilities or conditioning, psychological factor, technical and tactical factor, and some complex skills. So when we are making program of development program of kids, we should consider, as we considered before in talent ID, same fields also in development of the players. Testing basketball players, as I already say, so it's very important because how we can monitor our job, how we can see if they are healthy, if they have potential without testing. So we should make testing batteries, as we discussed on previous session with a different age group, but considering abilities which are mostly influencing on success in the basketball. And of course, it's very important in selection and creating database for the club and in national teams in order to compare today kids with Sabonis and Divac when they were under 16. This is very, very important. So practically from under 14, we can use almost same test batteries. But of course, for example, in under 14, if you are, as I said last time, if you are testing bench players, we are not doing one maximal repetition. We can make five repetitions. In under 16, under 18, we can also test them, just test them with maximal weights and to check them. Also, testing battery must cover all the fields which I already mentioned. So morphological test, motor test, or physical test, psychological test, and basketball skills test. Don't be pointing just on that. Of course, there are different softwares today. I don't know if you are familiar, for example, with Kinexon, with Catapult. There are softwares, okay, expensive, but in the long term, not so expensive. To monitor training loads in the real time, just one tablet or one computer, one person sitting on the table can control everything. How many kilometers they are running, how many meters, how many frontal runs, how many lateral stuff, how many jumps, heart rate in the beginning, in the end of the, in the middle of the session, height of the jump. So all the stuff you can measure today. So, but definitely our job as a coaches, or your job as a coaches, is first of all to learn something from that field and to be familiar with information. You don't need to follow step by step everything. You must have experts who can do it. But your job is to understand how to use all information from training monitoring and how to react, probably to avoid overtraining, to avoid injuries, but also to push your players on high especially during the competitions with most important character for you. Of course, we have teamwork, as I said before, but head coach or basketball coach must understand something from all the fields. In some points, we're supposed to be doctors. In some points, we're supposed to be presidents. In some points, we're supposed to be mothers, fathers, friends, psychologists of the players. This is clear. And because of that, probably this is one of the best jobs in the world. I hope all of you are with me adoring that stuff. Okay, sorry. There is some problem. Now it's okay, you can see it well. Are you with me? Are you with me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, we're here.
Yeah, it's okay.
Keep going.
I lost connection for the slide. Okay. Now next step is coaching. Okay. What is the meaning of word coaching? A lot of stuff. But first of all, we should understand that we are coaching people, we are not coaching the sport. Of course, technical knowledge and technical tactical competence is mandatory. We don't need to But we are coaching people, so we cannot implement same program with different kids. We cannot implement same program with different generations. Of course, program is similar, but not the same. Because coaching, as you can see here, is not something to do to the players. It's something to do in cooperation with players. So we should understand differences between generations, differences between the players inside the same generations, differences between the players in same generation, but different positions, and differences between also two twins, because it's not the same. So our job to understand, to be theoretically ready to understand all those stuff and be ready to implement those situations. Of course, especially in youth program, it's very important to teach kids lifestyle, so sports lifestyle. Because talking about under 12, under 14, they are doing in under 12 probably 3-4 practices per week. In under 14, 4-5 practices and game. So they're spending much more time out of the court. So if we are doing best practice in the world, 2 hours per day, they have 22 hours out of the court to destroy everything. With bad habits, with bad food, with bad influence of other people, with bad time management. So because of that, of course, we cannot be policemen. But from the first practice, from very first practice in youth, in under 10, in mini basket, we should start teaching them lifestyle, sports lifestyle. Because as they said before, if you are doing excellent practice 2 hours and after that you are going to drink 2 liters of Coca-Cola or something even wrong than Coca-Cola, you know, nothing to do because you cannot be Ferrari, you will be bicycle. If you're doing excellent practice and after that you're not going to sleep or you are going to be influenced by other people, other friends, nothing to do. So some other people who has less quality will beat you in on basketball court. So it's very important to understand concept of 24-hour coaching, which is important also for coaches. Then important stuff is to make the goals, long-term goals. I put some years, of course, it's just to check, you know. We have different goals and different time frame to achieve those goals. For example, after how many years of practices kids are arriving in the national team? Let's say 4 to 6. If they're starting to make basketball at 10, probably for under 16, after 6 years, they will be ready for under 16 national team. Just to think. So under 18 national team, 2 years more, 6 to 8. Senior club or senior national team, 10 years or 12 years. NBA career, probably 12 or 16. So we should make approximately time frame to reach our goals, long-term goals, and what to do in any specific year of their development. Of course, you can change it. It's not just about, I just put some numbers. Then we are going on the short-term goals, like easy stuff, easy. Looks easy, but very difficult. And this is our daily work. So regarding to the player's age, to their status, to their individual characteristics, we are going to decide about short-term goals. Improve free throws, improve low post technique, work on footwork, improve strength, speed, free throws, whatever. It's very important that we are going to communicate to our players, even kids, our goals, because if they know what they're supposed to do, probably they will be interested more, and definitely time to reach goals is going to be shorter. If you are doing just without saying anything to them, to parents, to their environment, nothing to do. So our goal is going to, our goal is not going to be short-term, but long-term. So it's very important to communicate to the players, to the parents, if needed, for something, yes, definitely we need. And to prepare time schedule or frame schedule in days, in months, in years, when we want to achieve that goal. Because if you are saying to many basketball kids, okay, one day you will be NBA player, this is really a long way. You know, so it's so far from that. But if you're saying, okay, let's talk about left-hand layup. We have 2 weeks to teach you left-hand layup. We have 3 weeks to teach you shooting mechanic. So like this, that goal becomes reachable for them. And it's very important for us also because we can test after that our work, and we can test what we made or if we made something good or well. Then we should understand, as I said before, other factors influencing on young players' development. Health status. So I'm doing with my kids and with players also minimum twice per year, 6 months. Family. In youth program, is very important to have family support. So this famous triangle, player, coach, parents. It's very important because parents should drive, they should invest money, they should buy shoes, they should spend time driving players on the practices, talking to them, like with young athletes for the future, very important. Then school and academic education. I believe even today that without education, it's very difficult to become top player, because top player is not just a boy or girl who is shooting well. They're supposed to be person, full package players, to know how to behave, to know their languages, to know how to behave on the press conferences, to know how to respect opponents, so all the stuff. If they have that stuff, they have quality more. As we said before, about when we discussed about NBA scouting report, you can see so many personal abilities and personal factors outside of court influencing on decision of the teams to invest money in some, let's say, good course. So very important. Living conditions, again, depend on the family, nutritional factors, you know, school education, all the factors are very, very important. So after that, personal discipline. Minimum sleep 8 hours during the night, but not from 2 o'clock to 10, because biological rhythm is completely different, as you know. So try to provide for them conditions to sleep minimum 8 hours during the night. And if it's possible, because of school activities, all other stuff, 1 hour between two sessions, if they have two sessions, very important. Time management, which is very difficult to control today. So Facebook, Instagram, mobile phones, computers, video games, this is so, so difficult. But as you know, all those facts together are affecting on their on-court performance. So definitely they cannot be without, but we should try to say to them, to explain to them importance or good management of those stuff. Other factors, travel factors, hours in the traveling to the practice, school, very important, because some kids are traveling 4 hours. I just find out on social networks a couple of days ago about football player Di Maria from Paris Saint-Germain. He said that 7 years when he started playing basketball for Brazil, for 7 years, his mother drove him on the bicycle with younger sister 30 minutes from his home to the practice. Snow, okay, probably not snow, but raining. 7 years, 30 minutes, his mother, his younger sister, and him on the bicycle, practice up and under. If there are not parents to support, nothing to do, even if with extremely talented kids. After that, money factor, so economical factor. If they have money, parents to support, or clubs to support, to buy the shoes, to provide equipment, supplements, nutrition, medical tests, examination, medical support, very difficult. Of course, mental ability, mental training, but we should start with under 14, under 16 to have some professional people who can help kids to mature well and to we focus on their practice, and of course other factors like friends, like family, because I said before, big influence. So we already discussed about commitments, and now we are jumping in our main part. So planning training program, how to develop talented kids, how to develop already selected kids. We should consider, like in all theory of sports training, some factors. First of all, volume of the practice or total amount of the work. It's very important to understand that we cannot kill them on the court, as I said before, but it's very important to understand that month by month, we should increase loading, because if you are staying all the time with same loading, they are not going to get better. So take care how to improve, arrive on the high volume of the practice, but without high volume of the practice, nothing to do. Because usually, if you are increased practice loading just by volume, they will get better. But of course, another fact, very, very important, is about age of the practice's volume before to start talking about intensity. I think that there is a consensus worldwide about time, practice time per week. Probably in Lithuania is same, as I discussed with some of my friends from Lithuania, more or less we are doing same stuff. So under 10, mini basket, 3 times per week, 1 hour or 1 hour, 75 minutes. Under 12, 3 times 90 minutes per week, and probably game during the weekend. And under 14, which is next age group, five times every day practice 90 minutes for weekend game during the season, probably just one day completely off. And talented players who are already national teams or in some good academies, in some good clubs, 16 years old, so cadets, they must have also two or three times per week individual workout or conditioning practice. So usually they are arriving on volume with eight practices of 90 minutes per week plus game during the season. So I don't know how the situation in Lithuania we can discuss, but I think more or less there is a consensus between basketball countries as we are. But very important part of planning is intensity, because basketball is very complex sport and intensity is crucial factor for players' development. Of course, volume, there is a consensus, but because of different aspects, different activities during the basketball game, it's very important to understand what we should do. Okay, sometimes it really looks like mission impossible to put all information in the players and coaches' head, but this is very important. Another stuff to consider in order to avoid burnout of the players, it's the number of the games. How many games per age group, and what is the relation between practices and games? Approximately, there is a consensus in FIBA Europe about the number of games, as you can see in this diagram. So under 12, maximum 30 games per season. Under 14, we are going on 45. Under 16, 55. Under 8, 65. But it's to consider, especially from under 16 and under 18, that kids are going to play also for two teams. So it's not same game in your age group when you're playing 30 minutes, and probably game in the older group when you're playing just 5 minutes. But it's important to consider if that is going to be home or away game, how many hours they're spending on traveling, if it makes sense to be in older group. We'll discuss in later on about some opinions. But this is also important to understand that we should define also number of games. Then, of course, from under 14, it's very important to record all data, because we should understand that following and making top players, it's process, it's not event. So if they are going to see how they're playing, if they're going to see their test results, for them, it's too difficult to be oriented, to be focused on something. Of course, for us as a coaches, it's clear, because without feedback, we don't know what to do. So we don't know how to develop. If you don't know how they're playing, if you're not seeing how they are performing, all the stuff, physical stuff, technical stuff, tactical stuff, how they are behaving in the team environment, we cannot go on. We don't know what to do. It's like giving the medicine without making blood analysis. So all the tests, all the stuff, also coaching points, coaching notes, in the end of the practice, as I said in the first session, must be recorded. Because like this week, when we are going back, so we can say, okay, this week was like this, next week like this, last month it was like this, year ago it was like this. What to do, in which direction we are going to push our players and to develop our players. So it's very important for national team, it's mandatory for clubs too. So how to control young players' development? As I said before, limit their number of games, limit number of the practices, limit their effort during the practice or loading, their results with top players from previous generations, or if possible, top players from different countries. It's not easy to find for all of us, but you should find a way to talk with friends from different countries to compare, just to see if we are on the right way or not. Of course, consider information from different experts, from different fields, and try to avoid only specialization at any cost. So don't use every time and all the time training technology for all the group, because this is the way to kill kids. Because especially in under 12, under 14, it's too easy to break kids, to break players, than to make them. So consider that stuff, because it takes time. In under 14, they have minimum 6 years more to arrive on the top level. So don't burn out them, don't kill them. When I'm saying kill them, you know what is the meaning of kill. To put them out of the basketball is damage. Physical development and injury prevention. Very important to understand which kind of activities we should do in some specific age. I will talk later more. I prepared some detailed information about the situation, but it's important to consider injury prevention as a part of strength conditioning program, and also as a part of players' development. Because any long stop, it's not like reading the book when players are going to stop because of injuries. Kids, especially big kids, but also top players, when they are coming back on the normal, regular practices, they are not starting from the same page as we are starting probably if you left some book on 22nd page, and after 2 years, we can start from 23. In basketball, in sport, is definitely not like this. So they are going back. They are going in minus phase before to come back on zero and then to progress on the hard level. So it's very important to understand all the aspects of training in order to avoid it. Of course, part of the injury prevention program is pre-season conditioning. It's education of the athletes about their routine before, after the practice, about their routine out of the court. Proprioceptive training, sometimes also if needed, some prophylactic devices, why not? But only for a certain period, not all the time, because no, even best devices on the world cannot replace tendons and muscles. So consider that stuff. For example, if you want to tape your players in under 14, or you want to get them stronger with tendons and with muscles, on their articulations, on their limbs. So it's very, very important to make, because wrong decision on that time, it's providing a lot of opportunities to make problems in the later part of their career. For example, let me share with you one true story from my experience when I was coach of under 16 national team. Six players from one of the best clubs in the Serbia. They start taping their ankles from under 40. Every single practice to avoid injuries. So of course, tape become their tendon. So their flexibility without tape was very, very limited. So one of the key players from my national team under 16, so he, a couple of days before to go in Lithuania, in Kaunas in 2009, on under 16 European Championship, you know, so he make injury, he make distortion of his ankle, just jumping from the bus. Jumping from the bus without tape, because his ankle was ready to react only with tape, because 3 years back in the three years, he always, every single day, he was taped. So after that, we just moved from some practice, or we move in cinema together one night just to make team building. And I remember when we jump out from the public transportation, he jumped from one leg, he finds some small stone over there, and nothing. Third degree of distortion, no European Championship. I'm sure that to be avoid devices, because as I said before, top devices cannot replace muscles and tendons. So this is very, very important to understand. Of course, there are different aspects of recovering all the stuff, but we have not time to discuss about that. That can be only one session. So what to do, massage, rolling foam, running, aerobic activity. So there are a lot of benefits we should know, but you should consider, coaches, that there are a lot of stuff just to sell to us. They just want to sell, they just want money from athletes and from sportsmen and from the clubs. So which of those recovering modalities are really useful for the players? Okay, cryotherapy, yes, but who will have that stuff? It's very expensive. Contrast water immersion, yes, very good. We can do it, and players can do it also at home sometimes. But there are some stuff, like, for example, compression garments. Okay, they are helping, but scientific research showed that it's very, very low effectiveness. So probably instead to spend 20 minutes after every practice, I don't want to say that we should avoid it. We should put out of our recovering modalities. But consider benefits. Probably for some young player, it's better to make 100 abdominals after every practice instead of walking 10 minutes with compression garments. So consider those things. I'm always old school, and I'm thinking that nothing can replace activity. Right activity, right practice plan. So consider those facts and try to find information about those stuff before to use it and before to spend money. Stretching. So scientifically approved that the dynamic stretching in the end of the practice negatively influencing on the explosive power and spread. So it's clear, as probably most countries are doing and most clubs are doing, that we should work on stretching, but dynamic mobility drills in the beginning of the practice, in the warm-up period, and then static stretching in the end of the practice. But also not too much, because it's not influencing well on explosive power as a main ability for our players. Electrostimulation, great, good. It's going to improve your, it's going to make shorter your recovering time to increase blood flow, everything, but that cannot replace move. So even any best electrostimulation in the world cannot replace stairs. So can be one part of recovering, probably during the injuries, when you have ankle distortion, when you cannot run, when you cannot do something. But of course, electrostimulation is great stuff to work on your quad to muscle tonus or something else. But coaches, nothing can change 8 hours of sleeping and good practice. So all those stuff are secondary stuff in our recovery, because as you can see here, nutrition, hydration, sleep or rest time, also top NBA players are doing that stuff. Because all analysis, I have one colleague who is working in Miami University, also doing stuff with Orlando Magic players. He's saying to me, okay, all those analysis, all those recovering modalities are good. They're using all those stuff. But if they have not 8 hours of sleeping and right drinking and nutrition program, nothing to do. Of course, like additional stuff, yes, but not like a main stuff. So don't jump in the trap of fashion TV. Definitely, we should have patience with young players. So I'm always saying that to develop young players, we must have two things, good practice and minutes on the court. So if one part is missed, nothing to do. I put here, of course, some examples from my country. So, for example, Pešić with Nemanja Bjelica, who wasn't selected for any basketball program before, coach Bogdan Tanjević with Gregor Fučka before, Pablo Laso with Dončić, Tanjević Bodiroga, Aito with Ricky Rubio, Dule Vujošević with Bogdanović, Satoranski in Barcelona, Sipahi in Fenerbahce, Dario Šarić in Cibona Zagreb. So young players, good practices and minutes on the court. It's too easy to say than to do because of other stuff, but we are talking here about good programs. We are not talking about influence of presidents, influence of agents, about bad coaches. We want all of us to be good, and we cannot go away from our road, from our way. And some key factors to develop young players is to keep them motivated. So we should involve them in program, in process. We should explain to them that something which seems impossible become possible after the hard work. So I like to say to my kids and to my students and to my players too, that you should behave as a champion before you behave champion. So before, when you are a kid, you should start doing champion stuff, sleeping, considering all the stuff, take care of what you are doing in the practice, out of the practice, how to engage your brain, how to engage your body, all those stuff you should do for a long time, as we said before, probably 10 years before to become top player. So of course they need to be supported in good things, and they should be focused on their goals. So to keep motivated kids, we should give them, as I said before, short-term goals, reachable goals, and long-term goals, you know, like cake and strawberry and the cake in the end. Definitely it's too easy to say than to do. So now we are jumping in technical stuff. After considering all those facts, how to develop kids. So there are different age groups, and there is a different content for different age groups. Probably this is most important part of today's presentation. Technically, as I said before, we should consider also physical stuff. So which abilities we should develop at the beginning? 6 to 8 boys, 8 girls, 6 to 9 boys. As I said before, speed, coordination, speed, aerobic endurance. So technically, they are ready to achieve new movements. So we should teach them basic, fundamental, basic moves and fundamental movement skills. First of all, without the ball and then with ball. So from technical point of view, we should teach them everything in basketball. One skill which should be considered from the first time, and you're probably one of the best countries in the world, is shooting. So if you're going, some students are answering to me when I'm asking them, okay, when are we supposed to start teaching kids shooting? They're saying in under 12, in under 14, because they're not strong enough to shoot the ball, because basketball height is 305, ball is heavy, ball is big. I'm always asking the same question. In under 6, under 7, when you are giving the ball to the kids, what they will definitely, they will shoot the ball to the basket. So they will shoot on the school court, they will shoot on the practices. If we are not going to teach them shooting mechanic, they will start shooting wrongly. They will create bad habits, and after that is very difficult for us. So even from 6, 7 years old age or group, age group, we can start teach them first of all to use legs. It's possible. Normal baskets, normal ball. Okay, you can give some easy stuff for them, provide for them small baskets, small balls at the beginning. Why not? But not for a long time. Because believe me, I tried with different kids that stuff. If you are teaching them to use legs when shooting, they can shoot with very good shooting mechanic even at that age, at the beginning of their career. Definitely footwork. We should work on footwork, so how to move without the ball, how to start, how to stop, how to change direction. Ball handling, stationary and on the move. I don't like too much stationary ball handling because this is not game-like, and always we should, as soon as possible, put them in game-like condition. And of course, basic movements without the ball. How to move, how to cut, how to make backdoor cut, front door cut, how to give and go situations. So all those stuff, you can teach kids from the beginning. Tactically, six of spacing and timing, individual tactic in one-on-one. As we discussed in the last Wednesday session, I say that we can divide basketball, as you remember, in 3 levels, individual technique and tactic, one-on-one game, both offensively and defensively, 2, 3, 4 players or group tactic, all kind of collaborations in offense and defense, and team tactic, 5-on-5. At the beginning, of course, we are working mostly on one-on-one because one-on-one is its foundation for everything. So what is the meaning of individual tactic? When and how to use skills. So for example, if we want to teach them shot fake and drive fake, We should explain to them from the first moment when we are teaching them technique in which situation they can use that technique. So, for example, defender is a little bit away from you. You are using shot fake to get him closer and to beat him in penetration. Defender is close to you. Defender is aggressive. You want to make separation. You are using drive fake to make separation. Then you can decide if he's not reacting, you're driving. If he's reacting, you're going back to shoot or to pass the ball. So this is the meaning of individual tactic. Of course, you are starting with some basic rules of free on free, like pass and replace, give and go, something like that, but not too much. Physically, I already said before, coordination, speed, aerobic endurance, because scientific research showed to us clearly that this is window of trainability for those three abilities. If we are not going to develop those abilities, nothing to do, or we will have less result. We are not going to explore full potential of the kids as they are going to explore coaches who are respecting training phases. Then next stage, girls 8 to 11, boys 9 to 12, what we should do? Technically, try to connect different skills, physical stuff and footwork, like running technique, jumping, stopping with basketball skills. Try to combine more skills, for example, getting open, stopping, shot fake, driving, dribbling, stopping, shooting, dribbling, stopping, passing, cutting, getting open, stopping, shooting. So in this age, we can teach them a lot of stuff. And usually we are going to combine and to refine skills teached and learned in previous stage. So this is next level of the video game. Definitely, we are going to add some new technical skill or skills like double dribble, like drive fake, shot fake, something else. So new technical skills, of course, and different ways of finishing. So today we have a lot of stuff, but let's start with basic stuff. Left hand, right hand, one step layup, normal layup, using the board, reverse layup. So I'll have to do because it takes time to learn. Usually, especially ex-players and non-experienced coaches, they want to skip some phases. It's not possible because if you are skipping something, it's like to eat ice cream after the soup without main meal. And we cannot correct that stuff. So if you're going to skip those steps, they will never be full package players. Tactically, of course, we are going to work a lot of one-on-one, a lot of one-on-one different situation, one-on-one half court, one-on-one full court, one-on-one closeout situation of the dribble, one-on-one plus one of the dribble game. So on the dribble closeout, off the dribble closeout, different spacing, different position of the court. So everything. Big player against small, left-hander against right-hander. Not all the time one point guard with another point guard, because in this age, we didn't make specialization by position. So we should give to also to big players to dribble, to pass the ball, because probably some Sabonis or Jokic or Divac in our team. And we have some, let's call it football player, who is better because he's mature already for his age than some big player who can be excellent top player in the end of career. So consider all those facts. In this age, we are going to add a lot of defensive stuff, like basic defensive positioning. So how to play defense, on-ball defense, how to play off-ball defense, how to play on the ball side, how to play on the help side, basic stuff like conditioning, jumping to the ball, close out, we should start doing that stuff. Technically, of course, we are, I think in this age is perfect age, as I discussed in the first session, to add some, let's call it special techniques. For example, off-dribble passing or pocket pass. In this age, why not? As I said before, if you start when they are 9, 10 years old, be sure that in under 16, in under 18, they will use that passing technique. And in today basketball, they cannot play pick and roll without using pocket pass, especially point guards and all other players, because today almost all the positions are using pick and roll. So think in which direction basketball is going to be developed, and think which skills we need for that. So we should make a list of skills, and we should add and refine previously learned skills and add complexity on those skills. Complexity like defense, complexity like decision-making, complexity, like less players in the short space, very important. And complexity, as I said before, like big against small, left-hander, right-hander, different profiles, they always mix, because more experience they have, it's too easy to them. Because if you're playing one-on-one in under 10, small against big, and if you're explaining to them what to do, how to do, be sure that in under 18 is not problem to play against switching defense. So, but if you start teach them in under 18, it's too late. They are already old horses and nothing to do. You can prepare versatile for them, nothing else. Physically, of course, we are going to use a lot of conditioning stuff, but mostly we are using body weight drills. So you should use, they should use own body to do something. Squats, lunges, steps up, side, step ups, abdominals, running up to hill, running down to hill, use the stairs, use the jump rope, use bench to jump over. So a lot of stuff. And of course, we are teaching them elementary dynamic mobility drills as a part of the routine of the players for the whole career. Definitely coordination drills and agility drills learned in previous age, we are going to develop, we are going to add complexity on those drills. So practically now, from that point of view, they can do a lot of stuff. I think that in this age, we're supposed to divide players in two groups, because from under 10 to under 14 is big area of improvement for them, and big difference between players. So they can differ in different stuff because of difference between chronological and biological age. So generally, just to put together, mini basket, talent ID, fundamental movement skills, basics of coordination, speed, balance, and aerobic endurance. ABC of running, and try to teach them natural, so-called natural form of movement. How to run, how to jump, how to stop, how to land. Two legs, one leg. Frontal, backward, lateral, zigzag. If they cannot, or if they don't know technique of basic movements, so-called natural forms of movement, how they can run with both. Especially because if you are going to teach them those fundamental movement skills, this is great investment in injury prevention for next part of their career. So definitely you should start to teach them, we should start to teach them from the first days how to do and what to do. So practically I already explained all those stuff, methodologies for conditioning for movement skills, as I said before, frontal movements, backward movements, lateral movements, and then zigzag. Two legs, jump, stop activities, then one leg. First of all, again, same methodology, frontal, backward, lateral, zigzag. Very, very important to understand importance on those stuff. Basketball, and we're discussing more about basketball, so understand the importance of teamwork, respect referees, opponents, all the stuff, and try to educate kids using the games. So because they like to play. They are eager to play. They are willing to come on the practice to play something. So be creative, show to them skills, teach them how to behave, how to respect, because this is very important also for other activities, for social inclusion, for everything, very important. Of course, basic basketball schools, we don't need to discuss about it. I already explained all those stuff. So in mini basket also, they should be familiar as a minimum with two basic basketball stance, triple threat position and basic basketball stance, and foundation and basics of dribble, passing, catching, shooting, and moving without the ball. Offensively concept, some basic stuff. By the rules, according to the rules, you cannot run with ball. Try to pass to player in front of you. This is foundation for fast break. Run in front of the ball. When you pass the ball, never stay on the same position. Run, pass and cut game. Try to keep good spacing, which is not easy because kids are usually running to the ball. All of them, explain to them, but if there are a lot of players in the short, in small space, they can just make trouble, nothing else. Basic defensive concept, again, as a basics of transition defense, try to run back to be below the ball level. So recognize your closest offensive player to guard, so like basics of matchup, and how to attack the ball and how to jump to the ball when pass is made. Next stage, under 16 practically, but two age groups. So basic level, we have here basic level and advanced level. Technically, we are starting to do a lot of stuff from basketball point of view. In this stage, it's very important to understand, it's not sensitive zone for coordination and speed because they are growing up in incredible way. In this age, it can happen that kids can grow up 30 centimeters. So we should understand that in this stage, it's not window of trainability for coordination, but of course we should keep working on coordination, understanding that we will get results from that work in the later part of their career when they stop growing up so fast. So very important to understand that stuff, because in this stage there is a first big difference in the height of the players. Some coaches will say, okay, this girl, bad coordination, nothing to do. They cannot play basketball and you are cutting them. This is one of the biggest mistakes. So we should understand that basketball is a game of big players, big bodies. So we should respect them more than small one. And we should understand that in this age, it's very, very difficult for them because of physiological process, because of hormonal process, because of psychological maturation. So this is very, very sensitive. And as I said before, it's much more easy to break players than to make players. And this is probably most sensitive part of their career, that age group. Defensively, we are going to add complexity, offensively too. So a lot of game-like drills or got a lot of game situations. Practically, we should teach them how to use previously acquired skills in game context. Tactically, we are working much more on 2-on-2, 3-on-3, 4-on-4. But of course, we are keep working on 1-on-1. Drive and kick game, understanding offensive, defensive principles, a lot of fast break situations, because we should teach them how to run, when to run, and how to react and how to make decision in full speed. So a lot of benefits from fast break. In this age, and I believe in all youth categories, so fast break must be main part playing basketball. Just to share with you my experience, okay, I'm sharing all this positive experience, but okay, we have some experience to share. So in 2009 and 2010, when I was coach of under 16 Serbian national team, we won third place in Kaunas, European Championship, and in following year, 2017, we won fifth place in the World Cup. So we played in 2 years, 17 games. I analyzed after the second year how many points we score from fast break and secondary break. I spend a lot of time on that. Believe me, every single practice, minimum 30, 40, 45 minutes sometimes. So fast break, running lines, corridors, options, handicap situations. And I was very proud, and I'm very proud even now to say that when I analyzed with some of my students, that we score 54% of our total points in 17 games in top level competition, under 16 European and under 17 World Cup, from fast break or secondary break. So that's mean that that work was paid off. So very, very important. So try to teach, because you can slow down the rhythm, but if you cannot give up the tempo, game tempo, and play up tempo game if you are not working in practice. Physically good, technically good, decision making we are working on decision making from full speed. So this is something like I like to call modern basketball, but this is normal basketball for us. Physically, we should retest them and to teach to keep working on more specific basketball skills like speed, agility, quickness. Repeat speed ability. So now we are starting with high intensity interval practice like suicides, like six courts fast break, because this is the age to develop them. In previous stage, it was very risky doing that stuff. So it's supposed to be made in previous stage in under 12, probably twice per week, but just 10 minutes. But here now we have ability physiologically, they are ready for repeat speed ability practice or for high intensity interval practice. So for example, suicide, six court fast breaks, four court fast breaks, can work also twice per week, but in preseason also 3 times per week, 30 minutes to 45 minutes. This is very effective because also science showed to us that doing high intensity interval practice, you are improving also aerobic endurance. So before we work more on aerobic endurance, now we are going to add intensity and we are going to reduce volume. Of course, we are doing some aerobic practices, but not in that volume, not in that number as we made before. Of course, we are starting with individual programs because, as I said before, we have two groups here, advanced technique, advanced group, where we are working with some advanced stuff, working a lot of non-dominant hand, preparing polyvalent players, all-round players. I'm talking here about usually national team, potentially national team players are in this advanced group. So improving shooting technique for different position, off dribble shooting, on the scuff the screen shooting. So different stuff, combination of different takes, double change between the legs, behind the back, different way of finishing, floaters, whatever. Development of decision making, which is very, very important as a part of basketball. And tactically, practically with advanced group here, we are doing everything like senior basketball teams. Why? Because in the end of this stage, they will play under 16 European Championship. So they should be familiar how to attack pick and roll, how to defend pick and roll, how to deal with full court press, with zone defense, with trap defense. So practically from technical and tactical point of view, we are in under 16 with advanced group. We are going to cover a lot of stuff from senior basketball. Physically, we are not going to do the same stuff. We are still avoiding maximal efforts, maximal loadings, especially with weights, because in this age, we should start doing serious weightlifting. When I'm saying serious weightlifting, I'm thinking about weightlifting drills with 50, 60%, 70 maximum of their one repetition maximum. It's very important to connect conditioning practice with basketball practice, so periodization become very complex. And of course, it's very important to prepare individual conditioning practice for prospect players. When I'm saying prospects, I'm not thinking just about prospects in national team. I'm thinking prospect players from your clubs. Every club has Kobe Bryant or Magic Johnson. So consider that and so take care about them. As I said before, under 12, psychologically, they have some characteristics and we should explore them. So for example, they like to participate in activities. They are eager to perfect skills. But from the other side, they don't like to lose. So it's very important to how to deal with losses, how to deal with lost games, how to deal with lost competitions on the practice. Try to support them and try to put players who are with the problematic behavior in the group with some good players. So like this, they are going to deal also with wins, not only to lose every single practice and then to go to play football, tennis or handball or water polo. So our job is to protect them. Of course, here we are teaching them basics of routine out of the practice. As I said before, we are learning overall basketball skills, development of fundamental skills. And it's very important to understand that in this age, we should work much more than play practices. So probably four practices, one game. Some young coaches, they like to play a lot of games because they don't know what to do on the practice. This is a mistake. How they can compete if they have not tools to compete. So individual technique and tactic, group tactic, and then 5-on-5. So they should play game or games, but not too much because they don't know what is the meaning of game. They are not able to use basketball tools and basketball techniques in order to be effective in the game. So as you can see here, I put also one game after 5 or 6 training. So practically every second week game, not all the time. If you have organized competition, this is something else. So I already discussed about that stuff. So under 12 is perfect time to teach them shooting mechanic. This is mandatory because without shooting, Kalates is great player, but he cannot score. So probably because of that, Pangos beat him almost 2 games. So just to confirm, so shooting without shooting, you are shooting country. So you are excellent in that, but under 12 is perfect age to teach them those stuff. As you can see on diagram, basic stuff like 101 plus 1, I already explained everything for under 12 and under 14. Conditioning, I also discussed that we should say, this we should work with body on drills, dynamic stretching, and in under 14, from conditioning point of view, we should add technique of weightlifting. So in order to be ready to jump in weightlifting program in under 16, we should teach them in under 14 proper technique. Here is very important also when organizing basketball practices to use principle different drills for same skills. So don't put the cones every day on the same position when working on dribble. Change position, change shooting positions from shooting, change moves before the shooting. So he's still shooting, he's still dribbling. But use this principle, different skills for the same skill, different drills for the same skill, because this is very important to improve coordination, to improve their peripheral vision, to improve their decision making. So, of course, here we can use, as you can see, elastic bands, heavy ball, floor ladders, jump rope, fitness ball, tennis ball. There are a lot of stuff. That everything depends from the creativity of the coaches. I already more or less explained all the stuff related to that stuff. Let me go on the next part. So, how to develop a winning team? Because if you have well-selected players, if you have talented players, okay, they should be developed in good environment. First of all, you as a coach, you should define your goals, short-term goals and long-term goals. Then establish operational schedule. What you want to do this week, next week, for 3 weeks. So practically practice periodization. Microcycle, mesocycles, macrocycles. Keep recording all those stuff, feedback from the practice plan, and try to execute your practice plan, because you will get better as a coach if you're doing that stuff. What you need, which kind of ingredients you must have to build good program. My opinion, probably I'm wrong, but I'm here to share my ideas with you. So talent. But when we are seeing talent, not only players, also coaches must be talented, as I said in the first session here. Organization. Very, very important to be well organized. We as a coaches and players, to teach them how to organize their time. Team concept, of course. We are not playing tennis, we are playing basketball. Always try to change word I to we. Discipline, without any doubt, without any discussion. Winning attitude, as we discussed in the first session, how to develop winning attitude. Working, organizing a lot of competitive drills. But as I say at the beginning of this session, if you remember, don't use competitive drills with skills which they are not doing correctly to avoid mistakes. And of course, leadership is coming out from those things. What we need from team, I prefer to have ambitious players and coaches, brave players, disciplined players, front players. Looks like Mission Impossible, like Coach Messina said in one clinic, that all of us, we would like to have good-looking wife, cooking well and loyal. But in the end of the story, nobody's on what is jumping in his hands. So same stuff for players. But we should have vision, and we should aspire high in order to know in which direction we want to go. About the physical stuff, body height and body constitution, speed, power. Three basic stuff. If you want to make simple stuff, it's like this. Of course, another stuff, very important, this is my idea I would like to share with you. It's about preparing specific practice template for specific age group. So for example, in mini basket, one type of practices, let's say one folder in your computer, can be development of fundamental skills. And then you will prepare 20 practice plan. Then this type of the practice, basic skills, development of basic skills using modified games. 1-on-1, 2-on-2, 3-on-3, different passing games, shooting games, whatever. Then complex practice. So I think it's very important for all of us to be organized. Now with folders or with paper, it doesn't matter, in a notebook, you can do whatever you want, but be organized, because having specific practice template for different age, you will be much better organized as a coach. And it will be much easier to prepare practice plan day by day. In under 14 and 12, we have different practice templates. General motor development, improvement of basic skills, connection between conditioning and basketball skills, goal settings, practice physically, technically, individual defense, group defense, group offense. So different stuff or practices. Or in the end, in season complex practice template. And after that, when we are making weekly schedule, weekly periodization, we are saying, okay, today, Monday, this, Tuesday, this, Wednesday, this. It's too easy. Of course, you are going to add your database daily and weekly and monthly, you're going to add new drill, new skill, new stuff, new type of practices if you want to get better as a coach. Under 16, practically, as I said before, technically they're supposed to do almost everything like senior teams, but not in that volume. Physically, no. Physically, they are not doing frequently high intensity interval practice. Physically, they are not doing maximal, they are not lifting maximal weights. From basketball point of view, a lot of same stuff. And another stuff which they are doing much more than senior teams, individual workout. So perimeter players, inside players, they are doing their stuff. Or point guards, something else. A lot of shooting practice because, as you know, if you want to, if some move supposed to become automatic, must get between 10 and 20,000 of repetitions. So if you start with shooting drills in under 18, you are not shooter, definitely. So start to use a lot of shooting drills and you can combine it with other stuff. Now, let's jump to the, I think that I will get a little bit longer, if it's not problem, 10 minutes probably more because I have a lot of stuff to share. It's not problem to go for next 20 minutes. Can I go?
Of course.
Okay, I will try to make it shorter, but I know now that I have a lot of stuff. So some stuff in Serbia. So during the season, we have not so many activities because players are involved in the club activity. So practically, I'm talking about situation when I was coordinator of youth program because it's going to be changed year by year. We have not system, I suppose to say, and I must say, we have not system. So new management, new history starts, which is wrong, of course. So we had some regional camps for under 16 and under 18, just weekend. During those camp, I try on the first camp, I try to test players at the beginning in September, October, to test them, to have results October. And every next camp, I was working on the weak side of their preparation, physically, technically, tactically. So, of course, watching their games and watching their performance on the practice, evaluation of their basketball performance from 101 to 5-on-5. I prepared some list of skills which I think that can be interesting. Simple stuff like 101 offense, 101 defense, with ball, without the ball. And then game understanding, basketball IQ. Of course, in those camps, I try to teach basics of behavior, athlete's behavior, so on-court and off-court team rules. I define staff responsibilities, so coaching staff and staff for team building. Competition system in Serbia, mini basket, nothing. Couple of tournaments during the year. Some clubs are going to organize games, but we have not any, or we have one tournament, big tournament in January, and one tournament now in this time, for Easter time. We have two tournaments officially. They are organizing something, but not too much. Under 12, we have regional competition at the beginning, first round of competition, 10 to 12 games, and then second round of competition, 10 to 14 games. And we have final four, but not final four on national level. Final four is just on regional competition because Serbia is not a big country as Lithuania is not big too. So we have 7 basketball regions. So in under 12, there is a no national competition, national final four or final eight. They are playing just between their regions. Next step, under 14, regional competition, same stuff. First round, 10 to 12 games. Second round, just they have more games because they have final regional tournament and they have in the end tournament between the regions, but there is a not club national competition. No pick and roll and zone defense. This is the rule. So they can use handoff, they can use in under 14 off-ball screens, no pick and roll, no zone defense. This is limitation in the rules for under 14 and of course for younger group. Under 16, we have national league, but this presentation is pointed more for under 14. So I think strengths of our system, our basketball, high level of competition, an appropriate number of games for each age group, a high level of competitive mindset for all kids, also sometimes too much, because parents are jumping to the floor also to discuss about basketball, of course, which is wrong, but we have good competition as a country always, as you know, as you are, I think the same, but there are a lot of weaknesses. So from the time when I wasn't in Federation, there is a not proper testing procedure for under 16, no selection criteria from different skills, all the stuff which I mentioned before. And selection is mostly based on technical and tactical skills because there is a not selection of coaches from the long term. Usually every single year they're going to change, we are going to change coaches, which is completely wrong from my point of view. Of course, there is a not profiling by position and different criteria from 1 to 5, as well as national training center. Nothing. We have not that. So very difficult because the Federation is going to nominate national team coaches usually after New Year, so in January. So it's this weakness is lack of program to control the clubs. And sometimes also clubs, coaches are arrogant. They don't want to share their, not knowledge, their program. They don't want to share what they are doing with some players, which is problem because they have players in the clubs 11 months and we have probably 10 and a half, 6 weeks maximum. Now, less, 4 weeks for national team program. So there is a not unified practice program for each age group, which I tried to do, but I didn't because of time limitation. And I think our under 16 kids, they have not enough experience on international level, probably because of money, because not all the clubs are able to do just Partizan, Red Star, Mega, three best clubs. They are sending players on internal competition, in the national competition. Some proposals, I'm saying for my federation, but I think that can be useful also for your federation. So we should provide best practice program, but federation should use scientific research. Federation should make selection of the coaches, and those coaches must be professional coaches or minimum engaged for 2 or 4 years in federation in order to follow up or one generation from under 16 to under 20, or to be only under 16 coach, because like this, we can build a system, because system means for me personal. So people are making system. So of course I try to organize also during the education process of coaches, coaching clinics on the country, but in every clinic in different regions, I try to invite the best under 14 players from that region in order to see them, to check them, to be familiar with their level. Of course, I'm thinking just for also for coaching education, because this is of course connected, that we should have unified program for the clinics for under 12, under 14, under 16 level coaches, because we should teach them same stuff. They should be familiar with all those stuff which I'm talking, what I'm talking about today. So what to do, how to train kids in under 12, in under 14, technically, tactically, physically, not only just basketball and final five game. So other stuff, competition must finish before in order to have more time for end of the school year and for the national team program, because usually competition are going to be finished end of the May, June. Now we are putting in the middle of the April, beginning of the May, which is the right timing, because after that they have time to rest, to finish school, to work on their individual weaknesses, and then to be ready and fresh for national team programs in the June, July, depending on which. A lot of international tournament is possible. And my idea was to organize also specific development camps during the season. For example, playmaker camps, best point guards in the country, under 14, under 16 together. Best big man camps during the season, 3-4 weeks. When I won, I made it 4 times per week, per season. So practically every second month, I organize 4 days specific camps for point guards. Under 14, under 16, and under 18. Why not? 20 players, it's not a problem to do with them. Of course, 2 groups, they are doing some stuff. It's important to have some national training center, but this is not a question for me. It's a question of government, country, but my proposal is like that. And of course, try to organize, I don't know, situation in Lithuania about regulations and rules between young minor players, under 18 players and their agents, because we have big problem organizing them and having them on all national team activities because of big influence of some bad agents. Not all of them are bad, absolutely, but we have problem. Playing rules, as I said before, in all under 14 in Serbia, it's forbidden to use on-ball screen, to forbidden to use no zone defense. And in under 14, so under 12 and mini basket, Passarella system, first two quarters, 10 different players, and only third and fourth quarters, you can use your best players on the courts. It's important also by the rules to provide for players to play for two age groups, and then how to handle this is another stuff. Basic talent evaluation form, as I said before, and I talked more in the first session about that, but I think that we should take care of some special basketball quality. If we have some special shooter, even if physically he or she is not good, keep them in the national team. Probably not as a key player, but probably as a backup player, because Milaknis is important for Lithuania. Of course, you cannot find so many other qualities except shooting and moving without the ball, but we should have some Milaknis in team, just to mention him. So think about it, our best defender, because we cannot have, I know that we are looking for ideal situations. We want to have 12 Kobe Bryants or 12 Sabonis in the team, but that never will happen. So have key players, and around key players, provide some environment who can be helpful for them to develop. Also, from competitive point of view, because sometimes you can find some early maturated players who can give to us something. Of course, not six players in the team, but one or two players like this in the national team, they're going to help to other interesting players to get that. So doing that stuff, thinking about Serbia system in former Yugoslavia was an excellent program. I was a part of that program. We had some Olympic hopes camp in under 12 for all the sports in one place, 1 week. 3 days of testing without touching basketball. 4 days just basketball practice after that. Clear selection criteria and recommendation for the club activities. They gave to us practice plan what to do in the clubs. I'm talking about 82, 83. And then, of course, bad coaches were involved in that program. I remember that time, Professor Nikolic was also over there. Coach Pešić was young coach, but he just started, so top coaches over there. So like this, we can create large database. And as I said before, coaches in Federation under 4 years contract, well-selected coaches, not friend of president or something like that. And like this, we can put also coaches with out of the comfort zone, because nothing will happen in the sport if players and coaches are in the comfort zone. So it's very important to understand that stuff and very important to follow that stuff. And some other recommendations that good result in youths is not always a fact which is give to us good results in the senior level. So we should make also consider categorization rated by biological than chronological age. It's not easy, but it's possible to make something. So try to organize national camps in under 14, because practically we have just 1 week from under 13, under 14, 1 week together, best Serbian players together, no camps during the season. So I think it's a big part of our system. Of course, try to check players' effort first and then their quality in youth program. And planning supposed to be made, next metro cycle supposed to be made on execution of the previous one. We must have practice plan, but not followed by letter in youth, because practice plan should be players-oriented plan, which is very important. If they're doing well, it's good. So it's very difficult because we are not singers, you know, we are conductors. So usually we are on the second behind the stage. And other stuff to consider, just some stuff, we need a couple of minutes more. It's always a question, how to recognize talented players. We already discussed last Wednesday. So they are learning quick, they are imitating well, they are using skills from the practice in the game-like situations. Their decisions are good, and they are ready to get responsibility. From mini basket, you can recognize that stuff. So they are asking for responsibility of the coaches. Usually top players are never going to give up. So they are crying when losing, but they are still sprinting, they are still playing defense, they are still playing basketball. They are analyzing mistakes and they are trying to transform minuses into pluses. Usually top prospect players, physically they are in the upper age limit. So there are some accelerants who are more on the high level, but we should consider also guys who are biologically or boys and girls behind. And another stuff which I think is very important, that as I said before, they must have some special gift, body roga, technique, decision making. Dražen Petrović, winning mentality. Teodosić, passing. Dino Radja, low post technique. Bogdan Bogdanović, out of screen shooting. Doncic, penetration pull up. Divac, passing. Nemanja Bjelica, passing reading game. Jokić, passing reading game. If we didn't consider those special gifts, most of those players will not be chosen for the national team. Teodosić, physically, nothing. Bodiroga was physically nothing. Doncic, physically, is not excellent. Okay, he's not Serbian, but I'm just saying from the Balkan countries. Vlade Divac, he was physically nothing. Jokić, nothing. But technically, they were from the first look, it was visible that they are excellent. So, as I said before, it's important to push top coaches to work with talented players. So, federation clubs must give money to good coaches. Definitely, because of loading progression, talented players must be pushed more than average players. So their training or practice volume must be higher, as well as quality or intensity of the practice. But if you are Ferrari, you should go 200 per hour. If you're bicycle, you will go 20. So if you're Ferrari, if you're going 20, this is nothing. You cannot get better. So you should push talented players. Of course, they must have high quality practice and game minutes. How to develop them? It's now a question, if they're supposed to play for their age, supposed to play for older group. I cannot say to you one true. So you should consider all the facts, because there are some players who cannot be bench players. Teodosić, he get crazy when he was bench player, and as you remember, if you remember well, even when he moved in Olympiakos, he get mad. He made so many problems because he was on the bench. I don't think that we should push him in starting five because of that, because definitely this is coach's decision. But to consider which environment in youth program is better for him to develop him, to be first best player in his age, or to sit and be unsatisfied in the older age group. So definitely best option is combination. So you cannot say. Another stuff, even if they have not other attributes and other characteristics to be on the higher level, if they have some special gift or some special quality which can compense other inferior stuff, they're supposed to be pushed in all the group. Divac, as I said, passing ability and charisma. Rađar, center or pivot technique. Kukoč, decision making. Dražen Petrović, shot. Dražen was starting five in his club when he was 17, and he fight for winning the championship of ex-Yugoslavia. Body roga in under 17, coach Tanjević choose him as a foreigner in the Trieste, Stefanel Trieste. So Doncic, so last one is okay, MVP of Spanish League and Euro League in 19. Of course, usually we're not going to meet that kind of players, but on the national level, on the top of the roof, we should find to learn from experience of those players and their coaches in order to understand how to deal with them. Another stuff, as I said before, they're supposed to be technically dominate in his category and very successfully one-on-one game with, this is my opinion, Dražen Petrović, Rađa Kukoč, Peđa Stojković, Bodiroga, Dončić, Šarić, Avdija. Danny Avdija, he was able to beat one-on-one everybody also 2 years ago. So that was a good decision to push him in the first team of Maccabi. Even physically under that level, but technically, yes, and putting him in high competitive level, of course, they will improve faster than others. Because you should understand that talented players are learning faster than others. Everything. So because of that, as I said before, better to have from the other side, you should push them to do something, because it's better to have them 10 minutes on the court on top level than doing wrong stuff, bad behavior in their age group. It's always better to have bicycle on the street than Ferrari in garage. Ferrari in garage means nothing. So another stuff to consider, if they can play one-on-one game, both offensively and defensively, and as I said before, if they can cover two positions in defense and offense. Another stuff, I put here examples, Vodiroga, Divac, Teodosic, Kukoč, Šarić, Avdija. If they can compense with technical stuff, physical inferiority, this is good. I will push them in this situation. Of course, consider also mindset of the players, strong ego, Dražen Petrović, Danilović, Peđa Stojaković, Dončić, Bogdanović, physically better than senior on his position, Dino Rađa, Danilović, Stojaković, even in under 18, they were much better than other staff. And of course, mature, socially ready guys to deal with older players. This is very, very important to check all those stuff. Another stuff, how to treat them in the team. So I think, of course, they should be pushed more than senior players. Push in way that they should work more. Coaches should be sharper and much more demanding with young, interesting players than with senior players. Of course, we should give them some more responsibility off court, on court. Okay, like, as we are doing all the time. We have not problem in Lithuania and Serbia with this. There is a problem in Western European countries that younger player on the team must come first on the practice, move from the practice last one, bring the balls, bring the bottles, give the bottles, take care of everything, because he's kid and he must get responsibility. Of course, we should pretend more energy from them in all game segments, especially defensively. And of course, sometimes to give them some dirty jobs, make free fouls, make strong foul, do something, as usually you are not going probably to do in the next part. Like all rich people are doing, they're sending their kids in the lowest position in their companies. So when they grow up, they know what's happened on so under. This is very important. Of course, we should praise talented players when they are doing something good, because experienced players, they have money. But young player must have support, mental, psychological support on behalf of the coach and coaching staff. This is very important. Of course, when they deserve. If they are not deserving, don't give to them anything, because they should understand that basketball is deserving something. Then how to deal with minutes on the court? Probably starting minutes on the game. You're not going to lose the game. We have examples because of injuries. Vukčević in Real Madrid. So no players, a lot of injuries players. You're not going to lose the game in the first 5 minutes. So give them chance. If they're playing well, you will give them more chance. If they're playing well, you will increase competitiveness between them and older players. So it's very easy. Give them some special tasks. Of course, if they are deserving, give them more minutes, not only during the trash time, but also an important part of the game. Sometimes organize some friendly games just for them. Of course, don't say to them, but organize some friendly games with responsibility, give them responsibility during the week to see how they will react under the pressure. Because as you know, pressure changes the people, can change them in positive or negative way. We should check it. If you want to use them, we should check how they will react in some situations. So when they're making mistakes, explain the reason of mistakes, support them. If they are doing bad stuff, punish them, but give them also support. Try to teach them to win practice before doing games. So their main job, practice, and they try to implement stuff from the practice on the game. Give them confidence, give them last shot, give them some offense, some play for them, and be focused on details. This is very, very important. So it's very important to teach them. And just to finish, sorry for time, but I think it was interesting, how to approach differences between young players and senior players. Young player, guided responsibility, senior players, responsibility. Young player, more energy, senior player, game quality. Young player, more mistake, senior player, more good decisions. Young player is going to earn minutes with quality. Senior players, already they have minutes. On court, off court support, and continuous corrections, because in the heart of the coaching job is correction. And all pretend maximal effort and raise level of their performance. Even if they can't, try to push them mentally, first of all. Senior players, different stuff, as I already said. And of course, in the end of the story, some, this is really last slide, some basic stuff, probably most for the rules of European Union. Sorry, I'll be back on. So some true or false opinions about youth sports. So if you are doing your best, you are winner no matter the results. I think it's true in youth program, especially in under 14, which was our main target today. Winning at any cost is the most important, definitely no. For me, most important stuff in youth program is that players are giving maximal effort and that they are using content of practice in the game context. This is most important stuff. Of course, behaving well, discipline, all this stuff. Sometimes you can win and feel like loser. Yes, if you are much better than some other team, you're supposed to beat them 50, you beat them 5. Of course, you should feel like loser. And opposite stuff. Order of importance, having fun, development, winning. I think this is right order. You can lose and feel like a winner, same stuff. If you give your best, you are winner. Don't teach parents and players just must to win. You should win if you deserve. You should win if you accept to be out of the comfort zone. And of course, not all of them can be number one because there are a lot of average players with a lot of trophies in career who behave as a champions without some special basketball quality, but they were the members of top teams. So because we cannot, as I said before, even best team in the world is not made by best 12 players. It's made by players who are working well together. So sorry, coaches, for the time. It was long session, but I think that it was better to complete in duty, to finish everything, than to cut some part because I made a lot of job. I spent a lot of time making that presentation, so it was for you, not for me. So, but anyway, thank you very much for your time, and feel free now to ask.
Thank you very much. It was very interesting, really. And you know, now it's time for questions, and we got some questions even before your lecture. But in most of them already you answered. So maybe you should just only, you know, short comments about them, okay? So for example, Dennis is asking, what is your opinion regarding pick and roll teaching and improving? When coaches should start to teach young players these skills?
Immediately, from the first moment, because I said before, individual technique and tactic. It's always connected. So individual tactic, we should teach them from the first practice of technique. So as I said before, when we teach, for example, kid shot fake, we are teaching mechanic, but we should supposed immediately say to them, okay, shot fake you are using when defender is away from you. Individual tactic, that's right. And then next level is to put them in game-like situation to see how they will react. So teaching and improving. So two different processes. Teaching when they are not tired, when they are fresh at the beginning of the practice, without speed limitation, without space limitation. Improving everything outside of comfort zone. Full speed when they are tired against opponent, against defense, short space, short time. Basically, there are two differences between teaching and improving, or learning and improving. So generally, I think that also in senior level, we are doing same stuff. Just as I said before, in senior program, those faces are shorter than with kids, but principles, methodology is the same.
Thank you. And next one, Karolis, he's asking, are the restrictions in the Serbian championship, for example, zone and other, and when are they removed? So
I didn't understand. Rules restriction.
Yeah, exactly.
So as I said before, under 16, only in under 16, we are trying to play everything. Under 14 are under 12. So no pick and roll. Okay, no defense. Basically like this, under 12 and under 10, passarella system, 10 players different players in first two quarters, and only third and fourth quarter everybody can play. There are basically rules in Serbia.
Okay, thank you. And Alfredas is asking, what is your opinion in an age periodization program? Coaches work only in certain age groups. For example, some coaches from 6 to 10, other coaches from 11 to 13, and so on.
I don't think this is a good idea. I think that if you want to be full package of the coaches, you should do everything, as I said before, because you cannot understand process, you cannot understand improvement, you cannot understand characteristic of the kids if you are not dealing with that. As we as a parents, when we are young, we are not understanding problem with adolescents. So after that, when we become old, probably in the end of the life, probably we will understand everything. So continuous improvement, and I think it's much better not be specialized just for one age group. It's better to start. I think personally that it's better that in federation also that you have one coach who is going to follow generation from under 16 to under 20, because in 4 years you can build a team, in 2 years you can build, but in 4 weeks very difficult. Okay, it's always we have pros and cons against that stuff, but as I said before, if you are sure in quality of your coaches as a federation, if you select them well, why not to give them 4 years Olympic cycle to work with kids? And after that, we can sit and we can say, Nenad, you are bad, go on. You are good, keep doing your stuff. So, because we need to take time. As I said, this is process. It's longer process than building EuroLeague team. Because building EuroLeague team is 1 year, probably. But building kids is minimum 4 years. So because of that, I think it's always better to have with high quality coaches, but to have time, to give them time. So don't be specialized just for one age group.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Next one, Henrikas is asking, what basketball skill is the toughest to teach?
Shooting. Shooting, because from coordination point of view, shooting difficult stuff. So you can see also on high level, when I'm saying shooting, I'm not thinking just about shooting mechanic. I'm thinking about shooting under the pressure. Because you can see, just one example to confirm. So last week, Barcelona Zenit. They miss 5 free throws in last 2 minutes, Zenit. Best players. So, okay, technique, super, great, no problem. Hanga jump on the court after 25 minutes on the bench, 1 3-point shot, 2 free throws, game winner. So it's not when I'm saying shooting under the pressure. But shooting under the pressure can be physical pressure, technical pressure, tactical pressure, psychological pressure. Because this is most complex basketball skill, it takes more time, and I think this is most difficult.
Thank you. And Jurgita is asking, motivation is very important circumstances for development. How to recognize the lack of motivation when players have burnout syndrome and how to avoid it?
So very difficult to recognize this problem to prevent, you know, yeah. Very easy to recognize, sorry. So because players are not sprinting, they are coming on the practice, they are missing some practice when they are coming on the practice, head is down, they cannot perform on their previous level, they are not smiling, they are not joking. So it's very easy to recognize. Because of that, it's very important, as I said before, to make prevention, making different drills and combining well practices. I should say, as I said, just about shooting. Like this, we have physical, technical, tactical, and psychological pressure. We as a coaches, we should combine in microcycle, especially with kids, we should combine different kind of pressure. But we should put them on the limit. One day psychologically, one day physically, one day technically. Not every day everything. Because way to burn out and to break players is to push them every day on the high level, physically, technically, tactically. Because especially in young age, it's much better to kiss some nice girl on the garden than come on the practice with crazy Serbian or Lithuanian coach. Just to be honest. So they have a lot of challenges. So our job is to organize, and one of the ways it's also to use this principle, different drills for same skill. I remember when I was player, long time ago when one coach said dribble, we knew everything, everybody. Elbow, half court elbow. That was only dribble drill for 2 years. So combine, do it some different, make every drill challenging. One day psychologically, one day physically, one day technically. So, and to do that, you should be smart and you should be creative, you know?
Thank you.
It's too easy to say than to do, of course.
Thank you. So coaches, who have more questions?
If they have any question after that, as I said before, my email is nenadtrunic@gmail.com. So feel free to send me, not now, whenever you think that I can be helpful. I'm always available. Don't worry about it.
Thank you. So coaches, I don't hear you. Okay, so we thank you, Nenad, very much.
Mr. Ramunas. It was my pleasure.
For a great performance, and for sure the knowledge you give for us will make us better coaches. And I am sure that I will make us better. What I want to say is that next year, FIBA Assembly will be in Lithuania, so I invite you, maybe we will meet in the Kaunas and the capital of basketball, Lithuanian basketball, and we will talk more about basketball.
Of course. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, first of all, from my side personally. Thank you very much also from the FIBA Europe coaching department side, on the side of them, Mr. Michael Schwartz, who organized that clinic in collaboration with Lithuanian Federation. And of course, I'm always ready and I'm willing to come in Lithuania to speak 24 hours of basketball, to spend some night times. You gave to see good games and make on-court clinics, which are much more useful than online. So thank you very much for your invitation and I'm always ready to come over there. So again, it was great experience. Please just also send this video to Mr. Michael Schmartz, because he will put also FIBA Europe coaching website. I wish you all the best. Stay healthy, stay positive, and hopefully we can meet personally in Lithuania. Why not?
Same to you, Nenad.
Thank you very much. All the best for Federation, for the coaches, and take care. Thank you very much again.
Thank you. So bye-bye.
Bye-bye.